So hi, for those of you coming now, the session did not start yet, don't be afraid. There's seats in the front, there's seats on from me, the right, and there are a few here. And this is a lab, so you are supposed to use your computer and follow what we do and then probably find bugs, maybe not. And these are our suggestions for setting up your computer for this lab. Best if you have a local Drupal 8. If that's not possible, then you can use simplytest.me, which is amazing, but if there's no Wi-Fi, however amazing simplytest.me is, it's kind of blocked from us. So yeah, so use the Drupal core project there and stop on the screen, and that's probably it for welcoming instructions.
Hello. You guys ready?
Yeah? Awesome. Yeah. Oh.
Welcome to the Drupal 8 Multilingual Hands-On Lab.
Yeah? Come on, it's the afternoon. It's after lunch. Yes. This is going to be awesome. Let's do it. Okay. So this wonderful man, I believe here in the back, said with content and config translation and core, Drupal 8 core is more multilingual than all of D7 with all of contrib. And today you get to have some hands-on experience with that. It's quite exciting. And hi, my name is Amy Degnan. I'm currently writing the Drupal 8 multilingual websites book. And I'm a enterprise CMS architect and the CEO of Hook 42 in San Francisco, California.
Hi, I'm Gábor. I work with Acquia. I also lead the Drupal 8 multilingual team, which is an amazing set of people. And you can find me at Gábor on Twitter. And we have several mentors today. We have Florian Weber in the front. We have Tobias Stuckler in the back. We have Carl Fritsche on the back. And we have Eric Steelstra on the side. And they are happy to help you with things. If you sit in the middle, you are out of luck. But if you sit on the side, then they can walk to you and help you out. And although it's only a few of us here, as actually some other people who worked on this initiative through more than 2 years now. This is a list of more than 1,100 people who we track being involved in some capacity in the initiative by commenting on issues, reviewing, designing, writing patches, etc. So there's a lot of momentum behind this work.
All right, about today's lab. We're going to be building on concepts, multilingual concepts in Drupal 8 because it adds complexity and different interfaces as you work through the system. We're going to quickly go over topics. That's why you have handouts and links to the information. It is being recorded. And you guys can see this online later as well. And like we said, the local Drupal 8 installation is preferred. But if you can't use this, simply test me with Drupal Core 8 Beta 1. The mentors here can help, and there's going to be some information posted for the post-lab reference. Okay. So what we're going to do today is we're going to walk through a group of people have been working on a Drupal 8 multilingual demo install profile that will showcase some of the nice multilingual things that you can do with Drupal Core. We're going to start with demoing that. It also works with Simply Test Me, but don't do that right now. Make sure that you're doing your lab setup. We're going to go over the installation and multilingual parts of installation. Then we're going to start building on the language module, interface translation, content translation, then config translation, and we're going to touch on some other supporting topics, like just a little topic like workflow, and then we're going to wrap it up with more information. But it is going to be quick. Just hang on for the ride. This is going to be fun.
Yeah, so Drupal 8, our main goal with Drupal 8 was in the multilingual initiative to make it possible for Drupal to understand language. So you will see that in many cases, we may not have achieved the ultimate best experience possible. But Drupal Core's task in our minds is to provide all the base features that then the other modules need to depend on. So a lot of problems that you encounter in Drupal 7 when you build Drupal 7 sites is that Drupal 7 Core does not understand language in several cases, and the language modules just try to like edit on the side. And in Drupal 8, our major focus was to make every part of Drupal understand language. So we built a layer where it understands language in every possible area. And then we built on top of that and enhanced it with interface translation automations that were not available in 7 and user interface improvements in that area. And then we brought in a content translation implementation from entity translation and unified that across the system. And then we worked with the configuration team to provide a translation system for the configuration. So if your site has configuration and content belonging into these categories, it's totally covered by Drupal Core for translation.
It's a lovely language-first approach, and as you add and extend to Drupal and through Drupal Contrib, I believe you guys are going to be very happy with that. Okay, so if you have not yet seen the step-by-step, link is bit.ly/d8ml-lab-handout. Do you need to look at this for a second more? You guys are all looking, so I'm going to wait for a second. Okay, you guys ready? I see squinting. It's a little bit small. Yeah. Okay. Ask your neighbor for help. Oops. And now we're going to start the demo. All right. Right now, I'm going to just kick off the multilingual install profile demo here.
So the goal with this is we try to show you where we want to get to at the end of this lab. This is open source. You can download that. It's available on Drupal.org, and we'll get you the link again at the end. But this is a pre-built profile on Drupal 8 that has some sample content and users and roles and menus and taxonomies and views and all kinds of other things that you would encounter and has them translated.
You can talk. I can walk if you want.
Okay. So this actually has 4 languages, so it will take some time to install. But doing this profile actually made it possible for us to fix several interesting issues in the Drupal installer. So for example, we made it possible to create profiles that instantly include multiple languages in the installation. So although you are installing in English this time, it will actually start downloading and adding several languages to your site because we've included them. So while this takes some time, I would like to highlight the first screen that you've seen, the Choose Language screen. So one of the advances that we made in Drupal 8 is we wanted to put language first because everything else in the installer may be confusing if you don't know the language. So we put the language selection as the absolute first step, and we built in a tool to automatically detect the language of your browser. So if we can detect that, then it's already pre-selected for you and it's available. You just need to hit save and continue. And then it's immediately downloaded on the next step, and everything else in the installer is in your language. Now, in this case, we selected English, so everything will be in English. But our profile includes multiple languages, so it will also download several languages. Now, language steps appeared magically in the installer because our profile wanted to have them.
What was the installation profile name?
It's on your first slide, right?
Not
on your first slide, it's in your handout.
It's a sandbox module right now, a sandbox project. So if you look up Amy space Degnan, it's one of my sandbox projects. And many thanks to Kristen Pohl, my business partner, for really taking a big stab at doing this profile work.
Oh, we are getting 6 hours. Wow. Thank you. 6 hours of runtime. So we took the content for this from the demo framework, and they made a good selection of content around travel. So this also evolves around traveling around the world, and it has some travel offers that have prices on them and nice pictures, and it has users who can create them and translate them, and it has some views and some menus and blocks to access them properly. So it takes some time to install. The reason is it's four languages, and it installs, and we just installed it from the ground up. So that's not bad, I think. For a site, it's not very responsive. Sorry, it's possible to add on later. Do you want to walk through the site?
Yeah, sure. Hi there. Who is familiar with the term demo framework? Okay, so what the demo framework is Acquia put together a really nice combination of Drupal contrib modules, content, and business use cases to demo against some of the larger enterprise CMSs. So Acquia could be actually competitive against some of these on a big enterprise. But it's a wonderful, beautiful set of some of the best Drupal things that you can showcase. But the topic is about travel because it's something everybody can relate to, and pretty pictures and everything. So on this site, it's about travel. And if we go to the About Us page, it's working hard. You guys are making Simply Test Me work really hard right now. But that's okay. Or the internet, one of the two. Anyway, this is a demo website. You can see that it's in English, Spanish, French, and Hungarian. Why? Yeah, it's taking its time. Okay, so what you can see here, this is a custom front page view. It's a list of products. Products are trips. So if you want, basically the site is a site that sells trips and asks the viewers to purchase them and add reviews onto the site. So it's all about showcasing trips through multiple places in multiple languages to purchase. So here we go. And then this is the demo over here, just a little explanation. There's a custom block here that says, hey, this is the demo. Okay, so we also have a contact form on the site. We have a views trip page. We have a sample of a product. We have a taxonomy of travel interests that are attached to each one of these tour products. Let's go see it in Spanish.
So So all the languages that are not English have been Google translated. So even the Hungarian, so please don't be offended. This doesn't make sense in Spanish. The Hungarian doesn't make sense in Hungarian either.
This is a demo. strong on the demo. If you'd like to contribute the translations, that's great. Okay, so you can see that, and that's it. And are we ready to get going? Let's do it. Okay. All right, have you guys got your local Drupal install going, or your Simply Test Me ready? All right.
So if you need help, ask one of the mentors, or raise your hands and one of the mentors will walk to you. You don't need to ask. Okay. So that was the demo, and I will start fresh with a brand new, we will use a local site, but you will use whatever you have set up on your computer. So we'll install this time in English, and we'll walk through adding on different steps. But if you check out this list, it's a pretty impressive list of languages that Drupal 8 is available in. And it all of them are displayed with their own names. So if you pick Arabic or something else, it will be right to left, right out of the gate as well. We'll install in English because that's the common language you speak, probably. And that will make it easier for us to add on all the rest.
Be sure to choose the standard install profile because we're leveraging some of the basic page and elements in the demo.
So we are choosing English here, but if you would have chosen a foreign language, what would have happened is it downloads the translation for you and enables the language and the interface translation modules so that it would be ready both in the installer and on the site in that language. We'll do it step by step so you better understand which module does what and where are the things and how they relate to each other. But there's easier ways to do it if you already know the details and you just want to start off in a different language.
Oh, yeah. Okie dokie. You can talk if you want me to type. Okay. Sorry. So we're just going to set this up. Travel the work.
Yeah, what's on my mind? Travel the world. Are we traveling the work right now? All right. All right. Let's just get past this screen, and we'll be admin. It'll be a super strong password. It's not a super strong password. And then we're just going to go ahead and save and continue.
So this demonstrates the situation if you're starting from an English site that's in English. And you will probably have that situation somewhere, somehow. So if you start with that, then you'll see that in Drupal 8, you have... That's not bad. So in Drupal 8, you have... Is that yours?
Yeah.
Let's try again.
That didn't do that before.
You don't have
no, this was perfectly set up.
Clear URLs?
No, seriously, I just did that. I did a whole test of this earlier.
Yeah, let's try to fix that. So if you have that English site, you'll notice that you have four modules to deal with language if you go to admin/modules. And now they are grouped down the page, so they are not like mixed in between the rest of the things. And those are language interface translation, content translation, and configuration translation. And what we'll start with is we'll enable language module and then see what happens. Because as I've said before, that's the base layer that provides language support across Drupal core. If you don't have language module enabled, then everything assumes you are English. So everything you do will do English, unlike in Drupal 7 where it's like it leaves around a lot of things that they don't know what the language is. In Drupal 8, the default assumption is if you don't have language module, then you deal with an English site. So if you want to have any other language on the site, then you would enable language module. And that will let you tell Drupal about languages and will let you tell Drupal about what type of thing is in what language. And we'll do that once we have a working system. It's hard to do a lab video recorded. Everybody tells people to not do live demos at DrupalCons, but a lab is impossible to do video recorded, so it needs to work live.
I hear that.
Yeah.
Thank you, Simply Test Me. So we're using Simply Test Me to
demonstrate that. So let's do that. So as I've said, you go to the extend screen. And at the around the bottom, you have these four things: language module, interface translation, content translation, and config translation. And what we'll do is we'll enable language module only, so that you know how far that gets you. If you enable a lot of other things, they interact in different ways, and certain screens will be more complex than you should see them at first. So let's just enable language module. Okay. So then you get to have a list of languages, and then you can configure some foreign languages on your site.
Okay. Are you guys ready? Did you enable the language module? I want to hear, yeah, okay, thank you. It's the afternoon. We have to have some energy. So we're gonna install French, Hungarian, and Spanish.
So what we do here is merely making these languages available to the system that will not make Drupal appear in French, Hungarian, etc. That's what interface translation does. We're not doing that yet. But we're doing this so we have these languages available. And that will let us do a lot of things on the system. So now that you have multiple languages, you can make decisions like what your default language on the site is. So you can change it to something else than English if you want. And you can make it choose your language on the page by different settings. So if you want to change your default language in Drupal 8, we made good care to hide that as much as possible. Because in Drupal 7, people change it and then it breaks all kinds of things. And that's not really true in 8, but it may still break some things. So we put that in regional settings, and there's a top option there to change your site default. The main reason that people change their site default is because they want to have a different language fallback for their language selection. And we have a solution for that that we'll hopefully soon show.
It's important when you first start architecting your site that you make those decisions about what your default site language is very clearly, just so you don't have to kind of figure it out later, because it's not amazingly straightforward. So.
Well, we're not going to change it now.
No.
Sorry. So what we're going to do is hope for a wireless mic, and also look at the language detection and selection settings, because that there are a lot of improvements there which make you not need to change your default language. So you may have noticed that when you added multiple languages, not their language detection and selection, then we now have these options to choose from them. And in 7, there was nothing enabled. We now enable the URL selection by default. And there's a very nice fancy in-place configuration screen there that lets you change that setting to be either by domain or by path prefix. And it previews you the actual URL that your stuff will show up. So if you go to path prefix, then you'll see that that's your domain, and then that's your path, and then you can see where everything is. So that's pretty cool. And then we have some other options that we've added and that we worked on to make language detection and selection easier. For example, we made browser detection configurable. So Drupal 8 now understands that the language codes that Drupal have are not universal across the world, and there may be people using different language codes. So we have a mapping of language codes, so we understand different codes for Norwegian and Portuguese and for Chinese, etc., and you can add new ones if you want. So that's pretty good for being a flexible system. We have account administration pages preference, so users can have their own administration language. And this is the best one, the selected language one, the last one. So if you want to change your fallback language for the website, you do not change your site default language. We have a configuration option here that you can change to use for the fallback language of the site. And then nothing else will change but this configuration piece that you actually wanted to change. So now it's tied to the site default, but you can tie it to some concrete language. So now it changes if you change the site default because it's a dynamic value. So that's what we have for language detection and selection. And this browser negotiation is the same feature that we use in the installer to pick a language for you to install. So that's how we select page for the language. Now, that's how we select language for the page. And then you can obviously assign language to things. So language module only, if you have language module that provides you a content language page, which is very exciting. It's going to be your favorite page in Drupal 8, multilingual, because it's a one-stop shop for everything to set up your multilingual content configuration.
So who set up a Drupal 7 like content translation and configuration for multilingual?
Yeah. How many clicks does that take?
Okay. Yeah, so let's just start there.
So in this page, this looks like a very simple, tiny page. There's a few checkboxes, but it will be a monster by the next hour. So so what you can observe here is it tells you that everything is uses the site default language, everything. So until you configure something here, everything will be English now because the site default is English. And then you can deviate from there. Then you can set up that you want something else. And then I think we have some pre-selected options that I don't remember.
That's okay. Mostly it was just to... So the way the page works is if you check box something, you can see all of the entities that go with it. So here's content types. And these were the content types that were installed with the standard profile. You can see custom blocks. There's a basic blocks type. Now, it's additive, right? So you can select everything if you wanted to, and the page gets quite long. And we have barely even added content.
So this page allows you to set up language defaults. So if you don't do anything here, then they will have language defaults. But let's say you want to create articles in the current interface language of the page all the time. So you can pick that one, and let's say you also want to let users to change the default language of articles, so you can say show the language selector. But for basic pages, you always want to create them in the site default language and translate from there. That's also possible. So you can configure very fine-grained all of your content, what default language it will be created in, and whether or not it has a user interface to change the language. So if you have a multilingual site, but you have a forum that's English only, then you can configure your forum to be always English, like assign English all the time, and the rest of the content to allow you to set multiple defaults or different defaults. So this screen is for that, and it's very flexible, and you can set whatever content you want. And this screen will get a lot more interesting later on in this lab. This is still a simple version of the screen.
Has anybody used the shortcuts menu before? Shortcuts? No? Yes? A little bit? Some? Okay, this is going to be a page we're coming back to over and over. So there's this magic little star up here. Click it. Click it. Click it. Okay. Yay. Up. Oh, it's gone. Don't click it too much. Be patient. Okay. So what that does is add it to my shortcut bar. So very quickly, we can come back to the content configuration page here, the content language page.
Let's create a block.
Did you want to talk about special languages?
Let's create a block.
Okay.
We are now going to create a block. Are you guys ready to create a block?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, I got the energy going. Okay, so let's go to, it's under Manage, Structure, Block Layout. And the page looks a little bit different than Drupal 7, if you haven't seen Drupal 8 yet. It's thinking very hard. One second. Okay, so what's interesting on this page is you have a tab called Custom Block Library. We're going to create a custom block. We can add a custom block here, or we can go to the tab and add it here. But I'm not going to click unnecessarily anymore. All right. And just to make sure, everybody, we're using Bartik. You don't change the theme or anything. 7 is by default the admin theme. So.
Yeah. So what's new in Drupal 8 here is you can place the same block multiple times. Yes. And what's new in Drupal 8 is you can create custom blocks that have fields on them. So there can be multiple custom block types that are fieldable and have all kinds of fun things. And by default, this is the default custom block, has a description and the body. And then you can place it anywhere any number of times and make it appear there. So that's pretty much what we're going to do. And then we'll show translating that later on once we get there. So we'll, for now, just create this block. Yeah, did you click that? Yes. So now we have that custom block, and now we can go and okay. Place it.
Sorry. I was going to place it the old-fashioned way.
No.
I'm going to place it the new way. Old habits die hard.
Yeah, so now you have a place blocks on the site, and there's all your blocks listed that you can filter, and you can place your block. And...
Oh, you want to do it?
Yeah. And the fancy thing here now, so I've said that content knows its language. And blocks also can know their language. In fact, they can be language dependent. So you can say this block will show up only for English and for Hungarian or whatever combination you want. So block visibility is also built into Drupal 8. So you can create content for different languages. Now you want to continue placing it and I can talk. So this can be used for a lot of tricks. So in Drupal 8, for example, the main menu and the secondary menus that are in the header are blocks. So if you want to swap them by language, you want to have different menu for this language, totally different menu for other language, block visibility. You can hide it in this language, show it in that language, or you can have a menu that shows for two languages and another one that shows for the other two languages, totally easy. And we are working on making almost every other component of the page a block, so you could hide them and show them selectively. But of course, views also exposes blocks, and the page, main page content itself is a block, so you can do all kinds of things with language visibility.
I'm excited for the block layout. So, but let's move on to taxonomy. Okay, so let's go into Manage, Structure, Taxonomy. And we're going to add a vocabulary. And the vocabulary name is Interests. I can't speak here. Yeah. Here, just watch me type interests. And then I just clicked save. So it should be. Then it's going to take me to add a term. And there's three terms from the sample site. And the first one is adventure. They're actually fun terms. So the second one is bar. It is. Welcome to Amsterdam. Here, I'm getting it. Beer. That was the third one on the sample. All right. Great. Perfect. So now we have a taxonomy. It has terms. Let's go back to the vocabulary and see it. And we have three terms, adventure, bar, and beer, all of which go together. Okay.
You can talk while I do it.
So we have a block. We have some taxonomy terms. Now we're going to create a content type that we'll work with. And I'm not sure you've noticed, but we haven't actually changed any language settings on the way. So we've just shown the language settings. So everything we create right now is English. although there's no language selector, and then we'll later configure this to support more languages, and then you'll see those features showing up. So we are creating this content type, and one thing that you may observe if you don't use the name product is that the machine name is automatically generated, and if you use funky characters in this field, then the machine name will be automatically transliterated in core. So if you start using funky characters, then you'll see the effect of that here. So that's the only place core uses transliteration right now. But the API is totally in core, and it may be used for file uploads and for other things later in the future as well. Does not use for file uploads at the moment, or path aliases either. But for machine names, yes.
That is a very good thing. Okay. It is. I'm so happy when I saw that. Okay. And just keep everything else by default. I did remove promoted to front page off of it. All right. So let's add a couple of fields. We're going to add a new field called interests. And that's going to be a term reference. There it is. And let's choose an unlimited number. And we're just going to choose the vocabulary interests and save field settings, basic site building things. And we'll just keep everything here by default. So click Save Settings. Okay, have we gotten that field in?
Anybody needs help?
Sorry, we can slow down. We've had lots of coffee. Go ahead.
So there's the entity reference field, and term reference is based on entity reference, and also image reference is based on entity reference. So there's multiple variants of entity reference, but this also internally is based on entity reference.
Okay, can we move on to the next field? Sounds awesome.
We can help you if you need help.
Yeah, we've got helpers here. Okay, so what we're going to do is reuse an existing field because the default standard profile creates an image field for us. So we're going to call this product image. And we're going to choose the image field. Now for this one, images are special. They have a file, and then they have alt text and title text. You want to make sure that you enable the alt field and the title field so we can actually type things into it and translate it. Exactly. Yes. This is great for search engine optimization. Okay, and I think that was it.
Yeah. Now back to
language. Yeah.
From shortcuts.
Exactly. Gábor is so happy that the shortcuts are happening. I am too. I started already using them very quickly. So go to your shortcuts and go to content language, and let's see what happens now that we've added more content types and other content fields. So it is. Okay, I'm going to be patient now.
So we've created a content type with fields and a custom block, and now we'll configure their language settings so that when we create the actual content, then we'll be able to do that in a way that we wanted.
Okay, so what you can see on the screen here now is that we've got the product is added. We've got the custom block added. All right, the taxonomy term. There you go. There's interests. All right, do you want us to turn this on now or later? Yeah. Okay. What's very cool is if you don't check this button now, it automatically checks later. Sneaky. Okay. All right. Okay, so we have our content tagged. Let's see. Let's go to let's expose the language switcher, and let's actually see what we're looking at on the site. So I'm going to go home, and we have created the base foundation for multilingual, but let's see if we can see that. Yeah, obviously we cannot see that it's a multilingual site yet. So let's enable the language switcher. Okay, so go to Manage, Structure, Block Layout. And what's really cool, oh, you know, it's because I've been in and out of, like, here. You can filter by this, here, language switcher.
Okay. And you can place any number of language switchers if you want to really confuse your users. Put at the top, it should be fun. Or hide the language switcher in certain language pages, also fun use case. want to box some people into some languages. But otherwise, yeah, it should be fine. So yeah, so that will place our language switcher and will not do much, right? Because we haven't created anything or haven't done any content. But the next step we'll do is we'll actually make the interface be multilingual. So what we have now is we have a content type to do our products. We configured it to have a language selector on, so when we add content for our product, then it will actually have the fields that we configured. It has the image field and it has the interests field. And because we configured it to show the language selector, it also shows the language selector on it, so it's now multilingual. So what the language module does is it allows you to create things in different languages. The use case for this one is if you have a blog and you post sometimes in this language and sometimes in the other one, it's totally fine. You have these separate posts. Or if you're a resource site and you just aggregate content from different places and you want to search that, then you can mark those content pieces as separate language. So this will in itself not allow you to translate content yet. What we're going to do now is we'll actually translate the user interface. So what we are doing is we enable the interface translation module next. And save that, and then see what happens. Magic should happen, but it does not. So ideally, magic will happen in this place, but it's unfortunately not happening, so we'll need to nudge it a bit to make magic happen. So we enabled interface translation module. It's still English. Whatever you click on, it will always be in English in every language. But we built this tool to automatically download translations for you. So the way to nudge this process through in this instance is you have available translation updates in your reports after you've enabled the interface translation module. And it will tell you that it never checked for updates, and now we are checking for updates. And then it will tell you that, hey, I have updates for French, Hungarian, and Spanish. It's a bug that it says it's for block module. It's actually for everything. And now you want to update your translations, and now the magic happens, and it downloads everything for you, all the translations in all the languages. So this is localization update module in core. That is that was a lot of work from Eric to get into core. And what happens in this module is that it knows about all the projects that are on your site. And also, it knows about all the versions of the projects, and it goes out and looks for whether there's translations available. And beta one, it was released in the morning, but we spent like 3 hours to ensure that translations will be available at this point in time, right here already, and they are. So the translations are available, and then you can download them. So the same process happens in the installer. If you pick a different language, then this happens already in the installer right after the first step. And it downloads your translation and imports it later in the process in the installation. So this now downloads all the translations, and then you'll have Hungarian, Spanish, and all the languages available.
Is this the same as the L10N module?
The localization update, yes. L10N update, yes. That's quite a long process because it downloads three big translations, and it imports them, and then it regenerates local caches of translations and stuff like that, but it's three at once. And the process you would have used in Drupal 7 is you manually went to localize.drupal.org and then figured out the versions and downloaded files and then downloaded to your own desktop and then imported through a web UI. Total bad. So now it says in Spanish that it downloaded translations because we've switched to Spanish before and nothing happened, and now I have a Spanish message on my screen that it says downloaded translations. And if you go back to the front page, then it will actually show even more things in Spanish now. And then you can try switching languages. And this is not from Google Translate. This is actual people translating Drupal 8. So that's how you get multiple languages automatically from the community.
Like, who's actually, is this the first time anybody's been playing with Drupal 8? Yeah? How many, is this your first day, like, actually downloading it and everything? Okay, good. Just wondering.
So what you can see here is there's certain things translated, like this block here, the menu and the label of the menu item. And the search block also. And there are some things that are not translated because this translation is not yet fully done, which is not a surprise. Beta 1 just released this morning. Don't blame the team. And then there are things that we created that have no translations whatsoever because we need to translate them. It's we created them. So we'll return back to translating them. But if you click around to whatever language you want, then you'll see that it actually works. Yes. Yeah, so the update interface translation feature depends on the update module. So if you don't enable the update module in the installer, then you will not be able to use that feature. So here's the French, for example. The admin menu is in French. At least most of the admin menu is in French. So like if you go down to these pieces, there's all the things that are already translated will be in French. So that's quite nice, right? And you don't need to do anything. This just magically worked. So we still have a user interface to finish the translation of this or change translations of these. So if you go back to regional settings, and maybe not in French, I can find the links in whatever language I want because I know where it is. But you may not find it. So let's do it in English. So in English, then you have this user interface translation screen, which is the hub for translations. And this is much more usable in 8 than it was in 7. So if you whoever used this screen in 7? Wow. It's so unusable, it's unbelievable. Like half of the crowd used the screen. That's crazy. So it's very unusable in 7 because it shows you the source string, and then there's a summary of translations available for multiple languages, and then you need to click into every summary, every single one, and then do the translation. It's crazy. So here, you have this two-column thing, and then you can translate it to the whatever language you want right away. And if you change something, and then go for a coffee, and then you come back, then you see which ones you actually changed. And then you can review them, and then you can submit them. So it's very quickly do this. And the other fun thing about this is that whatever you change here, these are quite harmless strings, so I can submit this one. So whatever you change here is now saved as a customized translation on your site. So all that downloads from the community and updates and everything will not touch these changes. So these are protected for you on the system. So you can look for translated strings that are customized. And they will list all your changes to the community translations. So if you don't like how your translation team translated Drupal, don't be afraid. You can do your own stuff. And if you have clients and you want to reuse this, then you can just go and export your customization. So I just customized this for French. Then I can export my customized translations in this language and then take it to other clients. So it's very easy to both depend on the community as much as possible. And if you really cannot convince the translation team of some translations, which happens in every language on the globe, I can tell you, based on the issues we get, then you can just customize strings and then use them. By any means, if you have translations that you can contribute to the community, please do so. But if you cannot, there's disputes, then you can do that. And you can configure how the update works. So by default, it will never run automatically, but you can make it run weekly or monthly. So it will automatically update translations from the community all the time on the site. That's probably a very bad idea on a production site. Because your translation team decides to change terminology, and then your client will be like, what happened here? So on the dev side, you can run it whatever times you want and then update these things. And then on the live side, you set it to never update and only manually update it when you push your updates to the server. And we enabled that process for you by downloading all these translations to a directory on the file system. So we download those translations and we keep them locally in a directory. So if you go to file system settings, then you'll see a setting now for interface translations directory. So all the translations that we downloaded are kept there as files. And if you put that into version control, then you can manage the deployment of these translations. You can push it off to your live servers and then run a manual import when the deployment happens. And there's no automated updates on the live server, and you can do the live updates on your staging and in your development environments and do the QA with that.
Sorry, question?
Yes.
What about if you translate something on the customer side and export the translation for deployment?
Mm-hmm.
Now it's a problem that we have always large PO files, and it's very hard to diff them. Can we export only the things we translated?
Yeah. So, sorry, I haven't stopped long enough. So the export screen allows you to translate only the export only source. That's the default option, and then you can pick a language. And then the export options have there's three buckets that you can export from. The non-custom translations that came from the community that you probably don't want to export, because on the other side they also came from the community, so you probably don't need them exported. The custom translations and untranslated. So if you ignore untranslated and non-custom, then you get only the strings that you customized. And then you can take that to the client.
Great.
Not bad. And we only use two modules of the four so far.
How do you share the community or translations?
What was the question?
How do you contribute this back to the community? So we don't have an automated way to contribute back from here. But since you are customizing it for yourself, you can take that PO file that only your customizations and then take that to localize.drupal.org and import it there. If you don't believe that all of those strings should be unlocalized, just some of them, then you need to manually remove the ones that you don't want to contribute. So we don't have a process for that. But we have this for separating the ones that you overridden and that you did not override. And then, finally, for interface translation, good news, there's something to do with English as well.
Who would like to translate English?
Yeah.
Yeah. Why do you think you need to translate English? German is better. Okay, that's awesome. Хорошо. Okay, that's Russian. The good use case for translating English is perhaps you want to say sign in or sign out instead of log in or log out, because sometimes this is basically like string overrides in Drupal 7. So let's edit this. And first we have to enable English translation. So I'm on the language page. I click edit. And you see that enable interface translation to English? Oh my gosh, save that. Okay, it's and I'm waiting. Okay. This is good. Okay, so let's go in. Yeah,
so what happens is Drupal 8 understands that English is not one single language anymore. Mm-hmm. And so you can pick English, and then you can search for your source strings, and then translate to English. So you can substitute English strings with other English strings, and then they will work the same way as before. The reason this is not enabled by default is performance, because those people who are perfectly happy with Drupal 8's UI as it is, they don't care about this, so they can have a speedier site. But those who care can do this. So if we try to visit this page, so that's already we are logged in and we just changed logout to sign out. So in the admin menu, it says sign out now because we wanted to sign out. And if we open the same page in an incognito session, so we are anonymous, then we'll see sign in for our user login a button. So you can change whatever you want in English. Yes, please, yes. And we are only on the second module of the four modules.
It gets better. All right. What page are we on? Let's do this. Okay.
So do we want to do a break now? Because we have five minutes to break, right?
Yeah, we could do that. Would you guys like to break now, or do you want to go on to the next module? Oh, wait. Okay. Hands up for next.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm not even going to ask about break because that was a majority. All right. But we understand and hear you. If you need to take a break, go ahead and stand up for a sec. Okay. So let's enable the content translation module because we need to translate content at some point. Let's do this. So manage... extend. I like that the module filter is in.
Yeah,
that it's so nice. Also, what something is interesting is you can, when you see the arrows on these the module page, actually after we, let's enable content translation. And then you can see underneath it has a configuration. So you can this is quickly going to the configure button in a different way. And it takes us back to our favorite page, content language page. But it looks different now. And the first thing to notice is that when you come back to the page, if you have language settings already set, it will default to those open and selected. But check this out. It's got a translatable column. What does that do?
That's straight out.
Okay.
Drum roll.
Whoa. How many clicks did that take?
So you can configure every field on the screen one by one. And also, it makes default assumptions about what you wanted. So Amy just clicked articles to be translatable. And now you can configure translatability field by field. And even better, subfields for image. Like you can say, I want to keep the same file, but I want to have a separate alt text and title text. But if you want to use a separate file, yes, sure, of course, you can use a separate file, but then you can do that too.
What does it mean to translate the publishing state?
So there's a lot of metadata about nodes, and these metadata will track your translation info. So this will track who wrote that translation. This will track if this translation is published or not. So publishing status per translation. This will track when it was translated. This will track when it was last changed. Is this translation promoted or not? Is this translation sticky or not, etc.? I don't think revision log message is a very good idea to translate, but we have it here. Yeah. So you can configure everything field by field, and then this page becomes a real monster when you start to click on these checkboxes. Then it will be pretty confusing. So that's the primary reason we started with language module first. Yes.
Okay, so just a short public service announcement. We've got a few power strips that'll be laid in the room now. So the technicians are actually waiting outdoor. Is it an appropriate moment to take a short break now?
Power.
So when you move back in after the break, those people who are in desperate need of power, those people should sit at the edges near the walls because that's where the power strips are going to be.
Yep. So, hey, we are back. So, let me answer a few questions that came up in the break, so you may be interested in some of them. First, there was a question of whether I actually need all of those translations on my site to just submit some posts sometimes in certain languages. No. So one of the reasons that we separated interface translation from language is you can still post in separate languages even if you don't want all those translations on your site, so that's fine. Another question that came up is language variants. So if you want to have different languages for different regions or different areas on the globe or whatever, Drupal 8 did not really move forward in that front. Unfortunately, I'm sorry for that. We've improved a lot of other things. But what's built into Drupal 8 right now is the API level support for language fallbacks on interface translation. So if you use the language fallback module, then interface translation has built-in support now to fallback between different language translations. So you can set up local variants for things and then translate only the things that are different in that language. We don't have a UI for that, but we have the API for that. And then there was a question on language names. So the language switcher block in our instance right now is every time English. But if you look at the demo profile that we've installed earlier, all the language names are localized to their own language. So they are native language names. So if you are Spanish, then you recognize your name, your language name. And if you're Hungarian, you recognize your language name. That's the default behavior of Drupal. So that's just not happening in our site right now because it did not export those translations. So you want to continue?
Okay, great.
All right, so we have our content types and our taxonomy. So let's make sure that we configure them to be translated and just double check that we did that. So I'm going to use my shortcuts to go to the content language page. And see, there's content and a taxonomy term. We also know that we want to translate the custom block. So let's just go through and enable. Let's enable everything. It's awesome. But, you know, if you did not want to enable the tags, you don't have to. So let's just enable interests.
So I think we did not want to enable certain things, right? So I think we did not want to enable the tags translation, so just to show that use case.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. I got all excited. I clicked all the buttons. See, now it's too easy. Sometimes you have to actually deliberately be careful.
Not even that. This one. So we chose for this demo to do some twists here. So we are enabling translation for basic pages and products, and we chose to not enable translation for interests. So what this means is that every language translation of a product will have the same interest taxonomy terms, but we will translate the interest taxonomy terms themselves. So they will show up translated, but it will always be the same interests for all the translations. Right, so that's the use case here. So you can do very fine-grained setup of this, like I don't want to have separate values for this, but I want to translate it because it's an entity reference. I just translate the entity that I refer to, and I don't translate the reference itself.
Okay.
Yes. Yes. Other questions? No? No. Okay. Yeah, so this works with entity reference. So if you translate the reference, that means that you will reference different values in different languages. If you don't translate the reference, it's the same reference for each language, but what you reference, that itself can be translated. So that's what we do with taxonomy terms. Magic.
And that's kind of where the flexibility of the localization and the extensibility of it is cool. But this is where if you don't watch your configuration and accidentally click too quickly, then, like me, then you'll be like, hey, this doesn't have the expected behavior that I want. Okay, so it looks like we're ready, and we saved. So let's just save again because I wasn't paying attention. Okay. All right, let's go add some content real quick. Actually, before that, let's add a role. Because now that we've enabled translation, somebody's going to have to translate this. And often it's not the sysadmin or the website Drupal developer that's going to translate it. So let's go into manage people. And when your people page comes up, then what we're gonna do is go to the roles tab, add a new role. That will be translator. Another place where the machine name transliteration happens. And okay, the translator needs certain permissions to actually edit content and translate content. And let's just get this easier. If you do edit permissions per role, it filters it. I know. All right, so the first thing that we're going to do is allow them to use the basic HTML and full HTML. We're going to have them do contextual menu, contextual links here. And then also if we go down to translate, we want to make sure that they can create translations, delete translations, edit translation. And look at, we have all of these things here for translate article content, basic page content. So let's go ahead and let's select these. Because they're a power translator at this point. See, they have translate any entity and everything. So this, we're giving some strength here. And let's click save permissions. And along the way, there are, as we enable the other modules, they do add a permission. That using the defaults is fine, but just on the help on the handout, you can go back and see where the permissions were added. So, okay.
So we did all that.
Okay, so what we did do, we went through like two pages of the handout really quickly. So we enabled the custom block, the taxonomy term, and the content type translation. All right. Let's create and translate some content. So go to manage content and...
anybody needs help? Yes?
Is it possible to give a translator the access to only a different language?
So the question was if it's possible to give translator access to a specific language. Currently, so in core not. However, the node access and the entity access system is supports language. So in 7, there was a node access system, and if you have separate nodes for translations, that's fine because they may have separate language. In 8, translation is inside the entity. So here we need to be able to provide access per language if we want to be able to tell people that you can only edit the English version of this one. That only allows you to sell access to different languages. So node access per language allows you to say, I sell access to you for these English things, and you can buy my French things if you want. So and they may be the translation of the same thing, and the user will not have view access to the French one if you don't give them view access to the French one. So it's as a very fine grain, it's totally possible to do. But it's not in core, it's not configurable. But node access, entity access modules will be able to use that capability to be per language access.
Okay, cool. All right, I clicked through a page while they were talking, so I went to content, add content, and I chose basic page content. Let's make an about us page. And I'm going to just put this in a menu. And I'm just going to keep it at the main navigation menu. And I'm going to save and publish, because this is an extremely in-depth page called About Us. Huh? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Thank you. All right. Do you want me to translate it now? Or do you want me to add more content?
Yeah, fine.
Okay. You guys ready to translate? Ooh, yeah. Okay. This is cool. Just like in Drupal 7, there's a nice translate tab here. And let's click into this page. And you can see all of the different languages. And what's nice about the translate tab across working with blocks and taxonomies and menus is the translate tab looks the same, and it acts very similar and the same. So once we go through this once, it's going to get very comfortable. So let's go ahead and add a translation, and we're going to add French because this is an amazingly in-depth article about us in French. I know, I did that earlier. So, anyway.
So, caveat of this form is the menu settings form part is not yet working with multilingual system, so it will change your default menu item, but you can translate your menu item elsewhere. So, the menu item is totally translatable. This widget is not integrated into that one. So, now it's translated to French. If you go to French, then it will be different in French. And this UI is also... Oh, that's not published to the front page anymore, right?
No.
Yeah. So this UI is also integrated into the contextual link system. So if you click the contextual link on this node, then it will show you the translate tab. And I wanted to show you an even cooler feature once it loads again. Shouldn't click on random things. Then it will also let you in place edit the node in this language right there, and I will be able to save that change. So if you want to in place edit this one, then you can do that if that shows up. But for some reason, that's not going to show up here for me. That's sad. Anyway, so if you have this entity in a view or something else, then you will have the translate access right there. You don't need to go to this page and do this translation. And if you have the quick edit module enabled, which we don't have, or we have some issue with it right here, then you're able to quick edit this translation. It's not possible to create translations from quick editing, but it's possible to change translations from quick editing.
And we'll have a view later.
Okay.
All right. So let's go ahead and add a couple of other ones. And I'm now translating in the French. I'm translating to Hungarian in the French interface. So.
Yeah, so this also tracks the source language of your translation. So if you go to the Translate tab, it will show you that the French translation was created from English and the Hungarian translation was created from French. It does not show that anyway. We used to have a column for that. No, that's fine. So if you go to the edit form, it has that source language field set that you can pick what source language you're using. And if you create it from English, that will be English. Yep.
Okay. Yeah, here, let me just show that we could change the source language. Oh, you can't anymore. Okay, I'm going to go back. All right, let's add some products. And I'm going to go back to English.
That's useful, yeah.
I can speak and read a little, but not in front of a demo.
So the product node form will look very similar because that's this is the node form that we have in Drupal 8. What will be different is we configured some fields to not be translatable. So you'll see that when you go create a product that some fields will say all languages. There's going to be a very subtle and easy to ignore note on them that they apply to all languages. So if you create a product, yeah.
Just a real quick thing about a real quick note about this content list. These all point to node 1, but you can see the instances of the page and language as separate listings, so you can find them very quickly.
It deletes the translation. So if you look at the product field, then that's interesting. It would show you that interests apply to all languages, which it didn't do for us. So that will be an interesting ride. We'll see how that goes.
Okay.
That's fine.
Okay.
Okay, and I'm adding alt text in here.
Cool, and then the translation form for this one looks pretty much the same as before, so whatever you want to translate is going to be the same process. And that's where interest shows that it applies to all languages, because when you create it, that doesn't really matter. But here, it shows you that it applies to all languages, so whatever you change will apply to every translation at once. For your translators, they will not see the fields that apply to all languages, unless you give them administration permissions for nodes. Then they can change whatever they want on the node, but they will have this all languages thing there. Now we have an issue to make this more obvious because it's very subtle, easy to ignore. You change it and then you're like, why is everything changed? It's a bug. And we are like, no, it's a feature. You wanted it to be the same across all languages. And it is. So that's how it is. It might have better UI. It might have a selector on the top that filters the fields by length. We'll see. But that's how it works. We don't want a menu for that.
I'm just so used to doing that.
And then Drupal 8 has this fancy big blue button at the bottom of the form, and you may have noticed that it says save and publish this translation, or save and keep draft this translation. So that's how the per language publication of the content is managed. So in Drupal 8, there is no separate checkbox for publishing something or making it a draft. But we have this fancy blue button that's very huge. Probably also needs some UX help if somebody wants to do that. Because it's save and keep publish this translation or save and unpublish this translation.
And so you can see I didn't publish the Hungarian one yet, so you can see it's not published.
When you do a block, when you do that and then a block.
Oh, yeah. Which one? Oh, translate the block?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
All right, are you guys all caught up? We're all up to the same speed?
No.
You need to create four translations.
Yeah, you don't need to create four. Just like, yeah, we can just keep going on. And mostly it's like, hey, you know where these buttons are. Okay.
Anybody needs help?
Okay. Right. We're moving on. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So manage structure, block layout. Now this is when I'm going to go to the custom block library. And I can click edit. Wait, I can't do my block.
No.
Not yet.
You can edit. No, you can translate it, but from the edit. Unfortunately.
Yeah, I'm like, it needs to have a link.
Still in operation.
I know.
I think we have an issue for that.
And the title isn't coming out. Okay.
So this one's very similar to translating the node. It has the same overview for translations. You can create whatever translation you want. It may have different values for author or who authored, when it was authored, etc. Blocks don't have these metadata by default, but translations track these data anyway, so you know who translated it when. So you can save that. And then we are about to move to a taxonomy term translation, but before we do that, I wanted to show something very cool, because later on we'll go to views. And Drupal 8 is a lot of places all about views. For example, this screen, Manage Content, is a view. So it shows all the translations of your things. And then you can filter for language. And you can say, I only want French stuff. And then you filter for French stuff. And then you only get things that are French. But this is a view. So you can, of course, customize this to whatever you want. So if you want to do the admin view and want to have other workflow things for your content, improve the workflow of how you work with content so you can manage what's not yet translated, stuff like that. You can add a new filter, and you can say you also want to filter for the source language of this view. No, the original language of this content. And then you'll have a filter for the translation and the original language. and then expose it so that users can actually use it for something useful. Did it actually do something or now it failed? But did it actually appear though? Yeah, original language, nice. And what's the in unknown? Nice, okay. So I expose it and whatever default value, it doesn't really matter. Apply that. And because that was a view, I can do funky things for my multilingual workflow, right? So now I have an original language filter. So what if I want to see things that have been originally English and have been translated to French? Why not? So you can do a lot of things with this and then do a lot of workflow support for your administrators, for your translators, by customizing these filters and then allowing them to do funky things. So this is, again, one of the things where knowing language about things, all that data, helps a lot in then fine-tuning your workflow to whatever you want. And it's very easy to do the same for the people view or for other views, the front page or whatever you want. Let's go translate taxonomy terms.
All right.
All right, so it's for this. Oh, I just need to wait. I'm waiting. I need less coffee. Okay, so manage structure taxonomy. And we have interests here. And you can see that there's no translate here because we need to go in and look at the terms first. And then the term itself, because it's content, we can translate it here. And look at the screen, looks so similar to the other ones. And it's very clear what to do. So I'm just going to add French to the adventure. And then it takes me back to the English page, or the English version of the term. So you click Translate tab again, and then you can do Hungarian, and then Spanish. And we'll just leave it there for French and Hungarian. But you know, we did not translate the vocabulary yet, so just the terms. That is absolutely done later. What was it?
Yeah, so for nodes, that a lot of the metadata is in the node form already. And for other things like taxonomy terms and blocks, the translation tracks certain metadata, like whether this translation is published or not, is tracked. Although the taxonomy term itself does not have a publication status. So in Drupal 8 still, you cannot say this taxonomy term is unpublished. That's not possible to say. But for translations, we are tracking that. So you can unpublish taxonomy term translations. There's a basic workflow. It's very similar to Drupal 7. You can flag other translations as outdated. Or you can track who authored it and when. So there's accountability of who did this translation and when did it happen. So that's what we track for translations.
You had a question?
Yes, the relation of taxonomy terms are accessible in the language, in the localized. I can edit the relations in the different languages, but they are all the same for each taxonomy terms. If I change a relation in a French term, then it changes also in the English term.
Yeah, so what Rolf is saying, there is a relations here that you can relate terms to others, and it changes for all languages. Yes, this probably needs the same all languages note, that it happens for all languages, that for some reason our API is not picking that up. And the most strange is language all languages. That's also somewhat confusing. It makes sense technologically, but it's somewhat confusing. So, so that needs to have the mark for all languages. Yes, definitely. So we have a sprint on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday in town. We're going to work on these issues. So if you want to come help fix issues that we find, we'll be here in this building on Friday and then downtown Saturday, Sunday. Very cool place. You should be there and work with us on fixing these issues. Be part of the 1,100 plus people contributing.
Can I ask something?
Yes.
Is the title of the blog, the custom blog, translatable or not?
What? Is the title of the custom blog translatable? Yes. We'll get to that later on. It's confusing.
Does it, I should see the note on my thing. It's like I can't find it.
It's confusing. So in Drupal 8, you can place the block multiple times. And the title of the block is the title of the placement of the block. So it, the title can be different per placement. So you can translate the title in the placement. I will do that later on. But the block itself is a content, is just the content of the block. The title is not coming from the content. It's confusing. It's probably translating a menu block is probably the hardest thing in Drupal 8 because it's like comes from three different places. But once you understand what's coming from where and you can pair up the translations with that, that makes sense. And then hopefully there will be contributed modules and the TMGMT module and the LingoTech module and others who gonna work on workflow to make this better, and so you don't need to understand that this text comes from the placement and this text comes from the content. But that's how it is now.
Okay, we're gonna make a view. You guys ready to make some views? All right.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So manage, structure, views. All right, we're going to add a new view. And the view name is products. And it would be show content of type product. And newest first is fine. Let's choose to create a page. And the page title was Latest Travel Destinations. And the path is trips. And the reason why we had a default product content type is just that's what we use for the multilingual demo. In our case, our product is a trip to somewhere lovely like Amsterdam. And the display format, what did I do? Let's see. Yeah, format table. And this is fine. We're going to create a menu link in main navigation. And where that link is going to be called trips. And at the same time, since we're here, let's create a block. And this is latest trips. And let's just choose, it's the latest trip, actually. It's a single. An unformatted list of titles linked and just one item per block. Oh, sorry, guys, here. I'm not going to press save yet. Let me just make it go bigger. Oops, not that big. All right. I'm going to repeat everything. The view name is products. We're going to filter on content of type product. Sorted by newest first. Click create a page. And the page title is just latest travel destinations or some personal title you'd like to call it. But the URL is trips. Its display format is a table. We can display 10 items. That's great. And then what we did want to do is create a menu link. And we want to put that in the main navigation. And the link text is trips. And then let's create a block. And it's called the latest trip. And let's just display an unformatted list of linked titles. And the list is of one. Because it is the first latest trip. Let me know if you want me to go through that again or if we're ready to go. Are we ready to go?
Yep.
Yeah, okay. It's hard to be here at 5:30. It's like it's been a long day. You guys are doing great. Very engaged. All right, I'm going to just do some housekeeping here. I'm going to change the display name on the page to the trips page, whatever I wrote on here. Okay. I'm going to click apply. You can see that the title, the content filters, and the formats came over from my first creation. I'm also going to change the machine name to trips page. If you guys don't do this already in views, you should do this. It's a good idea. It's very tidy. Thank you. Yes. Especially if you have to programmatically access your views, do that. Okay, what else did I do? Okay. Oh, yeah, let's go ahead and add the fields. So we're going to add the image. So we're going to add product image. And I'm just going to apply it to this display. We don't need a label for the image. And let's just keep it a nice medium image. And we're going to link that to the original content and apply. Am I going too fast? Okay. I'm going to add another field. It's the body. And it is chosen for this page only. So we're going to uncheck create a label. And everything is fine here to keep the defaults. Then I'm going to apply this. And you can see I have product one in English, product one in French, because that's the only translation I did for the product. It's the only published translation I did for the product, because we had an unpublished Hungarian one. Okay. So something like this, it's not yet ready for a language-specific view, because we're showing all languages at this point. So let's go ahead and add a filter. And this filter is it's translation. And the filter, now there's two of these right now. There's two in general, content revision and content. This is translation language. I want you guys to select just the content translation language right now because there's some issues with the revision one. So, and then we can just choose, okay, there. And then choose for this page and apply this display. And we're going to use the language selected for the user interface text. Oh, sorry. It doesn't matter? Oh, yeah. Okay. I'm just going to choose the first one for this site.
So there's at least two language fields exposed, the original language and the translation language. So you can use the original language to access the language that the content, that one piece of content was originally created. And one piece of content may be created in any number of languages on your site based on the previous setup of the default languages, right? And then a translation language is all the languages that it has been translated to. And since we combine it with the publishing status, it now also combines it with, is this translation published or is this translation not published? So you can filter with that. And then there's some dynamic options here to look for the language that Drupal selected for this page. So you can say this view's filtering depends on the language that Drupal selected for this page.
Yeah, there's a lot of different permutations and combinations that you can make, and it's really flexible, but you just have to be very deliberate as you put these configurations together because and how to test them, because you'll be like, hey, why is my content not showing up? and why is other content showing up? So with flexibility just becomes, you have to keep a very good eye on where you've configured things and what you expect it to happen. All right, I'm going to save the view.
So that's an option that we conveniently stepped over in the first hour. So the question was, I didn't see the undefined language. Is it gone? No, it multiplied itself. Now there's two of them. So Drupal 7 has language neutral, and people don't understand what it is. What's language neutral? So in Drupal 8, we made two of them. So you can be even more confused. So we found language neutral is probably used for multiple use cases, and we broke them down to two use cases. So one of the use cases is it's impossible. There's no linguistic content in this thing. So if you have a picture of a cat without any text on the picture, and there's no text associated with the picture, there's only the picture, then it's not applicable to say what language that picture is in, because like it's impossible. It doesn't have language. So for those cases, you can use not applicable. And for those cases when there should be a language because it has some text on the image or there is alt text for it, title text, etc., you can use not specified if you don't know what should be there, but something should be there, but you don't know. So for not specified is you hopefully fill it in later. For not applicable, it's impossible to fill it in because it doesn't make sense to have a language for that. And translation only works for actual languages. So if your content is not specified or not applicable, then it will be impossible to translate because we don't know the source language. So we cannot do any workflow on that or publication or whatever, that's not possible. So in Drupal 8, the front page, for example, by default filters by language, and it will not show anything if it's not specified or not applicable because that doesn't have language. So we don't know to show it or not. But you can customize the default front page is
a view.
So you can customize that, and then you can set up whatever language criteria you want as well. You've had a question?
Yeah. Would it then be possible to translate a picture? Let's say I had in the project, they had a picture with left-hand traffic and with right-hand traffic,
And they want to. Yeah, so the example I've said is very academic. Because like you usually don't store one image file and then no metadata around it. There's no title, no alt text. There's like almost never happens. So this is only useful for if you use an ISO image or whatever, a disk image that doesn't have a language. So for those use cases, yes, that's useful. But it's pretty impossible that you have a pure use case of I don't really have any language of this. So this is a minority scenario. It's not possible to delete this option on the user interface, but it's possible to remove this option with a module or you export your configuration, you import it back. So if you don't like that there are these two options and they are confusing, it's possible to remove it. It's not as easy as clicking on the link to delete it, but it's possible. Yeah, it's possible to have a different image. Yes, if you configure your image field to also translate the file, then you can have different files per language, yes. By default, it assumes you probably only want to translate the alt text and the title. Like if you run a product, like you have a trip, the same photograph of Amsterdam is applicable to whatever language you want. Yes. So you're way ahead of the rest of the group. So the views translation UI will do like in 10 minutes or so. So not yet, but we'll be able to talk about that. It's possible to provide context there, but we don't have a lot of context provided yet in the code, but it's possible.
Okie dokie. We have a view. We have a language aware view. This is awesome. I clicked apply. I'm not going to touch anything. Oh, that's right. Okay. Yeah, so it's only displaying one. Let's click save so it doesn't go away. Let's open the trips page. That should open. Oops, sorry. I do that all the time. we are human. Right, and so here's the trips page right here. Right, and here's where you can also find the edit the view, and you can, yeah. And here's your French product. Here's no Hungarian products. Sorry, it just hasn't launched yet. Okay.
Small country.
It's getting there. Okay, so let's go back to the view because we're not done yet. What I'd like to do is I'm going to clone the trips page view. Oops. And let's duplicate that page. And let's call this exciting trips page. I don't remember what did I type. Oh, exciting destinations. Yeah, it's a page. Okay. All right. And let's change the path to home. And here, this is also here, exciting destinations. And we're going to choose just this page. So I've changed the display name. I've changed the title. If your machine is responding, I'm going to change the machine name. And then let's change the format to be a grid. Just choose this display, this page. Okay, and you can see that there's one product. And it's still, oh, yes, thank you. And let's change the menu. And let's call this home. Because right now I'm creating my version of the front page home view. And I think that's it. Yep. Okay, so I'm going to click save. And let's go ahead and see what it looks like on the site. Oh no, there's two home pages. How does that happen? Oh no. So, but what we have up here in the menu is we have a menu item created by a view. We have a menu item created with content using a page. Content type. And then we have slash home, which is our custom front page. It's thinking about it. 1 second.
And what's the other one? Slash node, yes.
Yeah, and the other one is slash node or slash. And okay, so let's do a little housekeeping on that. And so we're going to go to the configuration. And site information. This is similar stuff to Drupal 7. Yep, same thing. So let's just type in our new view page home and save the configuration. And then let's just do a little other housekeeping. And let's go and take a look at the menu and remove that other home link. So manage structure menus. It's main navigation. Click edit menu. And then here is, which one is it? So I'm just going to roll over and figure that out. Our view is the second one. So I'm going to disable this one. And let's put that up. Let's reorder this.
And press. Because you just set the home view to the front page, and now you disable the front page.
Well, we can do it either way.
For this use case is like crazy ways, because I made a view page, and I made that view page the front page, but you can make a view block and put it on the front. Yeah. You know, yeah, there's many ways to do this. This is,
you can do it the other way around, yes. So
same thing. It's welcome to site building. It's this the permutations are great in Drupal 8.
So now, surprise. So what you did with the About Us page is that you created a custom menu item. So if you go to edit the About Us page, what? Oh, yes.
Yeah.
So if you created the About Us page as a content entity. So if you go back to your content language and translation, and you say, oh, I also want to translate menu links now, you can enable custom menu links on your content language and translation page, which will appear at a random place in the table. We have an issue for that also, by the way. And oh, I want to translate custom menu links as well. So you save that, and now you can translate menu items. So I've said that that's not integrated in the Node UI, but it's integrated into the custom menu item handling. So if you go back to your menus and your main navigation, now that you've configured custom menu items to be translatable, hopefully you'll have a translate link on your About Us page. Same thing as for everything else, taxonomy, terms, node, etc. And now you can translate About Us to French. And you may notice that the link title will be translated, and the link path applies to all languages. So if you change it, it will apply to all languages, but the description is language dependent. So yeah, so now you translated that menu item as well. And now what you hit, so you have this nice new front page, it works. You have the menu item, you go to French, your content is translated, your menu item is translated, amazing. But your block title, your block content is translated, right? But your block title is not, and your home is not, and your trips are not, and your site name is not, and there's a lot of other things that are not translated. And yeah, that's bad, right? That's very bad. But we have a solution for you. All of those, we have a solution for you. And it's one module. It's not 12 modules. It's one. So if I don't do that in French, then you can probably follow me better. Yeah. So if you look and explore the final module that we have for today, config translation. Oh, yeah. That supports translating everything that you have not been able to translate so far. Magic. So, for example, you want to translate your site name, right? You go to configuration, site information, and translate site information. Ooh. And you want to translate it to French, you go to add French translation, and then you get the form, two columns. You have the source on the first column, you have the target on the right column, and then you can translate this one to French. I would not try to pronounce this in French, but it's probably good. And when you go back to the site, it will actually be in French if you switch to French. So what config translation does is it puts in a lot of these contextual pages to translate things. So this was the site name. But the same happens with the block. So I've said that this is a block placement, and the block placement has the title. So now it's in the contextual links. So it says explore with us. You can say translate this block, and then want to translate to French, explore with us, French. Done. So you can do this basically anything on the site that you encounter. So if you want to translate things, you can go forward. Now I'm in a French UI. If I go to this product and edit my product, then you will see that my field labels, the title is translated, but interests and product image are not translated. So if I want to translate interests, what was that? That was the vocabulary. So I go to the vocabulary. And not that good in French, but taxonomy, noticeable. Okay, interests. What does it have? A translate tab. So I can translate that to French now. So interests, French. Good. Same thing, if I go to structure, you will not be able to follow all this, right? You will not be able to reproduce. But the fun part is I'm showing you, like, yeah, you can do it for everything. So you go to content types, and then you go to manage fields, and okay, I have these custom fields on my products, and I want to translate, oh, well, maybe the product content type itself, but if I want to manage those fields and then translate them, whoa, now I can translate them. So interests, I can translate to interests French. Yeah, label of the fields. So this is the configuration for labels. Is it translatable? So now I go to edit my French content. That's not showing up there, but is it showing up anywhere else? So what else did I change? I changed interests, and I changed... that's sad.
No, but this is for the label itself.
Yeah, I translated the... I translated the vocabulary instead of the field label, right? That's the problem. This one, right? Translate. Oh, this right there. Yeah, I don't know why it doesn't work, but all the rest works. So you can come on Friday, Saturday, or Sunday to the sprint and help us fix that. Mm-hmm. And now we should move. Yeah, and then the final fun stuff. So you need to translate home and trips, right? Where were those defined? In your view, yes. Translate view. Ooh, you want to have a French translation of this view, and it has everything. It's very scary. So it has all of your label for the view, the display settings, and then you want to translate your title, latest travel destinations, French. So you can do that. And you can do the same for everything else on the view. So this screen is very scary, so I wouldn't show this to people who are not really aware of what's going on in views because it's bad. But you can translate everything. So the labels, the empty text, the whatever other thing you configured in views, the separators, the pagers, everything. And then you save it, and now it's French. The path. No. That no. But the path alias is already translatable in Drupal 7, so same true in Drupal 8, so that's translatable as a path alias. So what did I change? A different page. So I changed the trips page title to French, right? Latest travel destinations, French. So you can translate views, menu items. This menu item came from this view, so same, it happens in the view. So you modify that translation, you just need to find where it's hidden, where the hell is the menu item in French. It was the exciting destinations, display options, home menu, and then home French. And then you translated the menu item that came from views. So that's what I said that if you... So that's what I started with. That this probably needs a cache clear or something. So that's what I said at the start, is you need to understand what comes from where. That's the only thing. Because we worked really hard to make you able to translate everything, everywhere. But you need to understand where it comes from, and once you understand that, then you can translate views, menu items, site name, content types, user role names, input formats, whatever you want. It's there. So if you don't like clicking around randomly with contextual links because you don't like that, or if you have a person who you do not give administration permissions to your views, which is likely there's persons... who you don't want to do that, then we have a config translation overview page that shows every configuration on the site, and you can go from here. And people who don't have permissions to blocks and fields and stuff can start from here and then can get to any translation page from this section. So if I switch this to English, then you'll probably have a better appreciation of all the things that are translatable, unless you already understand French, which is in this area is probably possible. So yeah, everything. So like you have contact message fields, content fields, custom block fields, date formats, image style names. Languages themselves are translated here, so the language switcher is gets its translation from here, user roles, et cetera, et cetera. So that was our lab. Yeah. Would you use Drupal 8 to build multilingual sites? Yeah. Cool. Any questions? I know, you're the heroes. Yes?
Maybe you told us, but maybe I forgot. How is it possible that I change the interface of the UI without changing the node content? I want to see an English node in a French surface.
English node on a French surface, yes. So it's possible to have separate language for content and interface. It's totally possible in 8. We did not show that. But we did not show a lot of things. So there's a lot more that we did not show. So if you go to your language config page, languages, and then detection and selection, after you enable the content translation module, there's this magic area that we did not show, content language detection. And you can customize it so it's different from your user interface language. So you can say your user interface is this and your content is something else. Also possible. Yes?
I want to ask about the field title. It's now granted in content life is translated, right?
Yes. So the question was field types. Do we need a title module in Drupal 8 or something else to be able to translate title? No. It's all built in. So all of those. So we did not use. So for the 2 hours that we've been here, this one only used Drupal Core. We did not use anything else. It's on SimpliTestMe. We started with Drupal Core. There's no other modules enabled on this site. Drupal Core only. And the title module is not required anymore because we have title support for node types, for menu items, et cetera, built in.
Because actually, in the early stage, I remember that it wasn't integrated by default in Drupal 8. It was something very hard to integrate. And,
Yeah, so there was a lot of work went into, especially Francesco Placella, who's actually doing a session. No, he did a session in the previous hour. About this, he did a lot of work to make these things possible that we can translate base fields of entities as well, yes.
Configuration translation stuff shown at the end there, is that then exportable using CMI?
So this is, the configuration translation is all stored in CMI. So if you can take these translations into whatever else you want. I don't think it tells you that you changed your translations. No, it did not.
Testing,
yeah, but yes. So it's stored in CMI. They are this called language overrides, and CMI also supports other types of overrides like domain-based overrides, and then they work together to figure out which is the best value to use for your page. So yes, it's stored in CMI. It's deployable. Yeah, so string context, there are two areas where we support string context. The first is user interface translation. So we support string context there, and we show the context for the string that you are translating right there. So if you look for why dot something, then you'll get date formats. I don't know why you're not getting the rest. But there are several date formats that use that. And then, yeah, that will probably not find the right one, though. So anyway, strings that have context will show a little blurb at the bottom that they have context.
Just search for, like, January or something.
You want January. You want May. May is interesting. Yeah. So May will show that this is abbreviated month name or long month name. So you know which context is for that. The reason I wanted to show the date formats is because they come from configuration, back to Ralph's question, because the configuration translation system also supports context. So all the date format stuff is translated in configuration, but they know that it's the PHP date format context because they are very crazy strings like y dot m dot blah, blah, blah. So translators get to know that they are in that context. So it's both supported in the user interface translation and in config translation. And the other cool thing that we haven't even shown here, but that was one question at the break, is that we support singular, plural strings here. And it supports every language. So if you have like 10 different versions of the string, it will show you 10 different, and you can enter them here. So that's all integrated in this UI as well. So it supports context and plurals, and it's all integrated nicely. Okay, so the only thing I want to ask you is to spread the news, tell everyone. And if you have availability, we'll be here on Friday. There will be a group working on localizeddrupal.org to upgrade it to Drupal 7. There will be a group working on fixing bugs in this one, and I've heard that there will be a group working on TMGMT usability as well. So because all the things that I've shown you, it's possible to translate things, but you really need to know where it is. So a workflow layer on top of this to integrate with third parties, to integrate with a translation management system, a memory system, or whatever, is not part of Drupal 8 core. But I think we got quite far already, so we are not ashamed of that. So there's still a ways to extend this further. But the main goal was to have language and everything and to be able to play that with views and translations and stuff. So thank you for coming.